escape from hell. It's about personal forgiveness. Personal forgiveness. This is the one that drew me to Jesus Christ. This is my testimony. I didn't have to be told I was a sinner. I knew I was wicked and I was enjoying it. I was good at it. But I also knew it was wrong, and in the end it would be self-destructive. And so when I heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, that if I put my faith, my belief, my trust in Jesus, he would forgive all my past sins, all my current sins, and all my future sins. My sins would be wiped clean in the blood of Jesus. My name would be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And when I died 100,000 years later, I would go into heaven. I was young. I thought I'd live forever. You know, it's one of those things, right? You know, when you're a teenager, when you're in your early 20s, you think death is for old people. You think you're going to live forever. That was me. I came to know Jesus Christ at 18. And it changed my entire life. Evangelists call this fire insurance. That's what they say, fire insurance. And it's sarcastic and it's hostile, fire insurance. It's where people come to faith in Jesus Christ wanting forgiveness of their sins and a get out of hell free card. And then they just, okay. I got what I wanted from God. Thank you. Now I move on. And they live their lives without God. We've experienced that, right? We see that all the time. People who come to faith to get something, and then move on. The problem is, moving on is evidence of not receiving the gift. Moving on, thank you for the fire insurance. I've now got my get out of jail free card. Now I'll go live my life like the devil that I am. That proves that I didn't actually receive what I think I received. There needs to be evidence of faith. And forgiveness has a lot of evidence, my friends. We don't take this serious enough. We don't. We don't talk about sin, evil, and wickedness enough. Sin, evil, and wickedness is biblical, and we need to talk about it. We need to warn each other about it. Because too much we justify evil and wickedness. We have our pet evil and wickedness. We go to great lengths to hide it, explain it, and to do it well. We don't take sin, evil, and wicked serious enough. My friends, whatever your private sin, evil, and wickedness is, it is a cancer set out to destroy you, even if you think it's a victimless crime. In the end, it will eat you alive. I'm the lifeguard, and I'm yelling at you to put on a vest and get out of the water because it's shark infested. Quit playing with the sharks. You're going to get bit. You are not immortal, and you are not invulnerable. And there's tens of thousands of people alive who thought the same lie you thought and was destroyed by it. And if you just listened to them, you'd show you were smarter than you're behaving. We don't take sin serious enough. We think, well, I'm a good person. I love talking to a neighbor who I'm trying to talk to them about the disease. We are sinners needing saved. And they compare themselves to Hitler and Osama bin Laden. Well, sure, compared to Hitler and Osama bin Laden, you're a saint. What are you really hiding? We are sinners needing forgiveness. And after forgiveness, we need victory against the sins of addiction. Against the things we are still struggling with 20 years after putting our faith in Jesus Christ. Because there's not only forgiveness, there's also victory. And I am so sick of scandal, famous Christians who have lived double lives, thinking they never get caught, and then they get caught. And then non-Christians see that hypocrisy and use that to say no thank you to Jesus. I can't imagine the consequences of being that kind of national stumbling block for people's faith. May God protect us from being a stumbling block to others. The secret to sin's power is keeping it a secret. That's why the New Testament talks about the light shining on it. When you confess a sin, it loses its power. As much as we don't like talking about sin, we never talk about hell. No. We don't even really believe in hell, do we? When we talk about it, we talk about it. Yeah, the Bible talks about Hades and hell, and oh yeah, hell's real. And if you don't put your faith, your belief, your trust in Jesus Christ, you're going to hell. That's what we say to one another, but we don't actually believe it. You know why I know we don't actually believe it? Because if you believe the lost members in your family were going to hell, you would be the annoying evangelical Christian in that family. Because they were destined for an eternity of pain and torture. And you would sacrifice your relationship with them for them to hear you for 10 seconds offering them the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. I know that we don't believe in hell because we spend all of our time and efforts gathering together and congratulating one another instead of going to the lost and trying to save a soul in the name of Jesus Christ. Put our money and time where our mouth is, but we don't. Come on, we don't believe in the reality of hell. We're just glad we're not going there. If we truly believed it, we would be feet and hands of Jesus, sharing Jesus with everyone we encounter, because we would see them in the chains and the fire that consumes. And we would want to make an eternal difference. But we'll agree with the doctrine of hell. Yes, hell's real, heaven's real, I'm going to heaven. But we won't put feet to it. And as long as we don't put feet, then we're lying to ourselves. We are lying to ourselves. And that lie is a victory of the enemy. Every time we pass up an opportunity to share Jesus Christ with a lost person, in any way, whether it's sharing your testimony, whether it's giving them a tract, it's handing them a Bible, it's asking to pray with them, whatever it may manifest, every time we say no, the enemy has won a victory. We have disappointed our destiny. Why are you even alive if you're not sharing the gospel here and now? That's your divine destiny. You can worship, you can pray, you can fellowship with the saints in heaven for all eternity. The activity we do here that we're not going to do there is sharing our faith with the lost, because hell is real. Because hell is real. Sin and hell. Forgiveness is also real. Forgiveness is powerful. Forgiveness is awesome. I knew I was a sinner, and I was so grateful to hear that my sins were forgiven. All of them, washed clean. I have been forgiven of so much. Matthew chapter 6, verses 14 and 15 comes right after the Lord's Prayer in Matthew chapter 6. And it's sentences that make us uncomfortable, which is why we stop at the end of the Lord's Prayer. Because verses 14 and 15 talk about how we show evidence of our forgiveness by forgiving others. You want to prove that you are forgiven by God? Forgive others. I have been forgiven of by God by for so much. I mean, galaxy-filling sins, evil, and wickedness. He's wiped them clean. He has forgiven me of so much. How dare I hold anything against another human being? How dare I? The height of hypocrisy is to thank you for the pardon and then hold somebody guilty for violating an HOA rule. And yet that's what we do, and we do it all the time. Why? Because we're not known for our love. We're known for hypocrisy. We're not known for forgiveness. We're known for judgmentalism. Instead of forgiving, we judge. And we do it because it makes us feel better. If I can point out the three things you're doing wrong that I'm not, woo, ain't I better than you? We'd never say that out loud, but that's what's going on in the back of our brains. And every time there's a little gab session,